Good evening to all of you who have joined in this second episode of this session that what mylaw.net is organizing exclusively for teachers. This is a session on discussing about different methods of teaching law effectively. So in fact, as I told, this is the second episode, and many of you who are here today might have listen to me in the previous session as well. So in the previous session, I was only talking about the need for honing up our skills as law teachers. Like, first of all, we need to know why we are teaching, and then once you know the real object of why to teach and what to teach, then the most important thing comes is how to teach what you want to teach, so that you will reach, take your students to the place, and that you can map it with why do you want to teach that thing. So it's very simple. So in the previous session that I was discussing about mostly the objectives of teaching, and at the end of the session I introduced you to a new word called andragogy, because as teachers we are very familiar with the word pedagogy. And when we talk about pedagogy, we talk about child learning. And then last week, I concluded with the difference between pedagogy and andragogy, because adult learning is a bit different. Their expectations are different. You can't treat the students in a university the same way that we teach or we treat students in a Montessori or a kindergarten, or in a primary school, or in a middle school, or even in high school. Because at different levels, they are different, and their expectations differ, and their learning abilities differ. And therefore, we were talking about the importance for law teachers to understand the science called as andragogy, the adult learning. So that is where I stopped. And in fact, I told in the previous session that this session I will be actually getting into the methods of teaching law. Yes, so this is I can only talk about different methods that are there to teach law, and therefore this session for the next 40-45 minutes I'll be talking to you about the importance of lecture as a method, because that is the most commonly used method, though there are plenty of other methods that we can use actually to teach law students in the law schools. But due to various reasons, India-specific reasons, with respect to the kind of law schools that we have, mostly financial reasons, that there are not many law schools have the financial capability to experiment new methods of teaching, because new methods will involve a lot of cost. And similarly, I've seen law schools even without projectors, without screens, without PowerPoint, without a laptop, without a dedicated internet connectivity, and all these issues. So therefore, facilities are also a restriction, it's a limitation. So financial reasons, facility wise, and many law schools, though they have all these things, but then the curriculum is so tightly packed that you teachers do not have the necessary time to experiment or to try new methods. So teachers also find it, because of pressure of time, that it's good that you go get into the class, talk to the students for 40-50 minutes, and then come out. So you feel that, okay, you have completed your course, you have delivered a lecture, you have completed the syllabus, that's all. And a very important factor that we have in our law school is the large number of students. Mostly, though the Bar Council has fixed up a limit for each section, they say that you should not have more than 60 students, but then you can see most of the law schools, though they admit only 60 students per section, but in practical sense, they try and combine all of them and make them sit together and deliver one lecture. Yes, these are various factors, and therefore, keeping into account all these limitations, because I'm generally talking to an audience about whom I do not know much, because I do not know who are the participants today in this session. I'm trying to generalize things. If this program would have been in a classroom-based program, then I would have specifically found out the actual reasons why we could not use methods, or depending upon your own limited resources available, that how are the, what are the other methods that you can use in the classrooms. So this is something which I felt is the need to talk more about lecture, because lecture is a predominantly used method in almost every law school without an exception. And therefore, I felt that let's today discuss more about this method, which is currently in use almost in all the law schools. Therefore, this is very important. Therefore, for the next 40 minutes, I'm going to talk about this method. When I say that I'm going to talk about this method, I'm going to tell you how do we scientifically prepare for a lecture, and how do we need to structure a lecture, and how we need to deliver a lecture. Right? So this is an art, actually. It's a skill that you need to acquire by practice over a period of time. And that is why, you know, even during last session, I appreciated my friend Nikhil and his team behind Mylaw, that for conceiving this idea of talking about law teaching methods, and therefore they gave me this opportunity to speak to all of you today who have joined me in this session. So therefore, in today's session, for the next 40 minutes, we are going to talk about lecture as a method. And maybe at the end of this session, I believe that all of you will be at least be able to understand the importance of or the different stages involved in preparing a lecture, the importance of structuring a lecture, and the style in which you need to deliver the lecture. So these are some of the things that I'm going to do, and I believe, I'm sure that at the end of this 40-45 minutes, all of you will be able to be very familiar with all these things, what I'm going to tell. Maybe the last 15 minutes we can reserve for discussing few questions, and therefore, and that's how we can conclude this session. So this is the plan for today's session. So as I told you, this is a method, though we say that there are plenty of methods. In fact, when we do an FDP, for example, recently we did one FDP. I was the person responsible for conducting this FDP at Sri Lanka, which was funded by the Asian Development Bank. When we did this FDP, we did it for 5 days. And every day, there are 4 sessions. So 5 into 4, 20 sessions. And we conducted each session in a different, using a different method of teaching. So that, you know, we successfully used a 20 method of teaching law. Even without knowing that it's something different, you know, people gave a wonderful feedback after 5 days of participation. So there are a lot of opportunities available, but yeah, let's see if time permits, then we can move ahead and go on one by one. But I think I should start with the lecture method, and that is the justification why that I'm starting with lecture, because it is the only method which is used in 100% of the law schools, not only in India, even elsewhere, throughout the world. A globally recognized method of teaching law is lecture method. Only thing is lecture, we were not trained on delivering lecture. We do not know the intricacies involved in delivering a lecture, and therefore we were not quite sure as to how to do it. We have, whatever we are today, we have learned it by just trial and error method. The same is with me as well. Until in 2006, I got an opportunity to participate in a few training programs where they focused completely on this method. And then when I participated in it, I realized how ignorant I was. And by the time I had almost completed more than 10 to 12 years of teaching, then I felt that, in fact, as a teacher, I should have, instead of only preparing to deliver a lecture to my students, in fact, I should have spent some time in finding out, learning the strategies or the skills required in delivering a lecture and how to do that. And therefore, that's what I'm going to do. And therefore, I felt it is very, very important. And whatever I'm going to tell you today, it's not if you are an experienced teacher who are participating in this program, if you are in this teaching profession, it's not anything new. I'm just going to organize things which you already know, and I'm just documenting it. But certainly it will be something new for those of you who are planning to join teaching, especially the postgraduate students, or if there are any freshers who are looking for a career in teaching. I think for them, you know, something that what I'm going to tell might be interesting, something new. But for other teachers, there is nothing new in it, except that I'm just putting things in a particular order where I have just documented the experiences of delivering a lecture. Especially, it's just a culmination of all these processes that what we involve. So maybe that, you know, whenever I'm going to talk about in this next 40 minutes about lecture, I will only try and fine tune the method to meet the requirements of the generation which is currently in our law schools, because every generation is quite different. For example, lecture method was one method which was successful in producing all the stalwarts in the legal profession today. They were not trained by different law teaching methods. So they were all, they could acquire the necessary knowledge, skills, attitude, everything only through lecture method. But the generation which is currently in our schools today, in our classrooms today, are completely a changed generation. This is an internet generation. It's a technology-based generation, which they call it the millennials. And then, of course, the millennials have also entered, and from this year and from next year, you can expect a lot of post-millennials joining the classroom. So we need to understand them also. It's a very, very important part in preparing the lecture, so which I'll be taking through. So this is what is my plan for the next 40 minutes, that I'll be talking about three important stages involved in a lecture: the preparation stage, the structuring of the lecture, and the delivery of the lecture. And then I'll conclude with a few tidbits, a few tips for making these lectures very effective, and that's all. So let's go ahead and presentation to all of you. I just made a small PPT, which I thought I will share it with you. I think I'm not able to share this presentation. Nikhil, or the host who is a co-panelist here, can you please help in allowing me the access to share the presentation? The message says that the host disabled participants' screen sharing. So can I request the host to please give me the access to the necessary rights to share my presentation? Otherwise, you guys will have to just keep looking at me talking about this presentation. Is the host available? But I think they are not there. In fact, this is something which is a very, very important stage in preparing for a lecture, that you need to be. Can I just hold on for a minute? Yeah, but then it says that the host has, it says host, I press the share button. It says host disabled participant screen sharing. So I'm getting this message. Yeah, host disabled participant. So you need to give me the access to them. Yes, sure, sure. Until then, I'll keep talking. Yes, right. Because interestingly, I said that I'll be talking about the different stages involved in preparing, structuring, and delivering a lecture. This is very, very important for us to understand this, because if you are not structuring your lecture properly, in fact, it will be difficult for your audience to understand it, understand what exactly you are talking. I'm going to show you some pictures to help you understand this process, the importance of structure. For example, you know, I have a quote from Sir Winston Churchill. Of course, he said this quote is about the parliamentarians in United Kingdom, the British Parliament. But I'm trying to relate it, and I think it is mostly applicable. In fact, if you talk to students, they will only say this about our teachers. So the quote goes like this. It's a, before they get up, they do not know what they are going to say. When they are speaking, they do not know what they are saying. And when they sit down, they do not know what they have said. Quote unquote, Winston Churchill. This is, you know, most of the time it is true for some of the teachers, that they go prepared and they do not know what to say first and what to say second and what to say third. In fact, they switch the order and there is no sign language involved in teaching. There is no voice modulation involved in teaching. They keep talking for 45 minutes, and at the end of the 45 minutes, students get disturbed. Rather than acquiring knowledge, they become very put out that what is it that had happened to them. So therefore, how do you deliver a lecture is something very, very important. And that's where I would want to quote again Winston Churchill, who says that, you know, the teaching should be very tactful. Whatever you are telling students, you should tell it with a tact. And therefore, we need to know what Churchill means by tact. So Churchill says, I quote Churchill, he says, tact is the ability to tell someone, go to hell, in such a way that they should eagerly look forward for the trip. This is what he says. So it's not what you say, it's how do you say things is very, very important, not only in diplomacy, but it is also very, very important in a classroom scenario, because this is something which we need to know. Because I've seen, you know, many law teachers who have tremendous knowledge in that particular subject, but then they are not a very popular law teacher. That's because students, after listening to them, they will not be able to finally take notes of what actually was taught to them. They said that, yes, sir, in fact, we were there in the class. We know that sir is very knowledgeable. He knows everything. But then, unfortunately, sir, we could not understand anything. Being an academic administrator, I have been dean and director of various law schools. So I get this kind of feedback from students, you know, talking to me about the other colleagues. And then, you know, we need to actually work with those teachers to understand what exactly they are doing, and therefore, this is one of the reasons that why I thought that I should talk to all of you. Yes. So I think, Nikhil, now I can share? I'll try. Yes, thank you. Yes, so thanks to Nikhil that he could quickly resolve the technical glitch, and this is what the presentation that what I want to share with all of you. So as I told earlier, that today in the next few minutes, I'm going to talk about the stages involved in lecturing. First is, let's take up preparing a lecture. This is, it's very important. In fact, my teachers, my gurus in teaching, they always told me that if you are not prepared, please go and leave. Rather than entering the class and trying to manage the class, which will very poorly reflect, and then it is going to affect you for throughout your career. So I never took the risk of entering a class without adequate preparation. So therefore, preparation is very, very important for a teacher. And without preparation, please do not enter the class. And then, you know, as I told, I'm going to talk about structuring a lecture and delivering a lecture. Now, these are, you know, how do you prepare a lecture? What do you need to do first? First is, you should know why I am teaching this topic to the students today. At the end of this lecture, what my students will be able to learn from this lecture. So this you need to be very clear. Then you can plan your lecture. For example, if you want, at the end of this lecture, my students will be able to understand the essentials, the requirements, the structure of drafting a writ petition. And then, you know, in the next class, you actually give them an exercise and then make them write. Then it will be very useful. And then you can test whether you have attained your object or not. So therefore, identifying the object of your outcome. So whenever you prepare a lecture, just note it down and see whether you are going with a clear set of objectives. That at the end of the next 40 minutes, what my participants will be able to do. For example, even before the commencement of this session, I told that at the end of this presentation, all the participants here will be able to understand the different stages or the processes involved in preparing a lecture, structuring a lecture, delivering a lecture. So you should know exactly that what you want your students to know and how your students will be benefited at the end of this 40-50 minutes of lecture. So you need to be very clear as to the objectives. Now, you know, most of the modern universities who are complying with the requirements of NBA and NAC and other things, now they have started writing the program objectives and the course objectives. But now, you know, there are a few, very few universities which also still go one step further, and then they prepare lecture outcomes. So for each lecture, they prepare a set of objectives and a set of outcome which they verify, which they check basically. So therefore, the first stage involved in preparing a lecture is you should know the object of delivering this lecture on this particular topic. Why do I teach this subject? Why do I teach this topic to the students today? How it is important for them? What my students will learn from this thing? This is something very, very important. Second is, I think all of you can look at my screen. You know, it's it has a picture of, I think, 9 animals. So this is picked up from a journal article published by a Japanese educationist who had, you know, after a long study, he had classified students in a classroom by comparing with the behavior of few animals. So this is widely the kind of behavior that you can expect in a typical classroom. Of course, this is not the rule. Without exception, there might be exceptions that there might be a class where there is no monkey. But then most of the classes has monkeys, most of the classes have hippos, so most of the classes have frogs, dogs, rat, and all these animals that whatever you see on screen. So he says, the author says that each student comes with a different set of behavior, because not everyone is same, and Therefore, they come from different backgrounds, with the different skill sets, and therefore each one of them is different. But in a class, you will have to take care of everybody. So you can't, we can't afford to have a one-to-one coaching session, which is not possible in a law school. So in a law school, when you have 60 students in your class, each one of them is quite different, and therefore you will have to manage the class and take care of all these things. So first thing, while preparing a lecture, this is the second one. The first thing is identifying the objectives of your lecture. What is the objective and what is the outcome of your lecture? That you will know. And second is, you need to know your audience. This is something very, very important. Of course, in an online program where we do not have audience, it's very difficult. But still, if when Nikhil asked me to talk on this, I asked them, this was my first question. To whom am I talking? Then Nikhil said that it will be a mixture of postgraduate students who are many, many young people who want to take up law teaching as a career. And then there will also be in-service teachers. So there is a mix of people. That is why in my introductory part, I said that some of you will have the experience. Some might be new who are intending to join. This is the entry behavior I learned from the organizer of this program, Mr. Nikhil, who is planning this event. But in a typical classroom setup, if you are teaching the class continuously, you will certainly know who is and what will be the kind of questions that they will ask. So this will help you to prepare adequately. Like I had a discussion with my wife, who is also a law teacher, and she once came and asked me that what should I answer if a student asks a question like this. It was a very difficult question, and then I immediately did not know the answer. But then I only told her that, why are you worrying this much? I don't think anyone will ask this question. She immediately said, no, you don't know this student of mine. She named a particular student and she said, I'm sure that this student, when I'm going to talk about this topic, he's going to ask this question to me. And therefore, without knowing this answer, I'm not going to the class tomorrow. So this is the level of preparedness you need to do. And while preparing, you need to know your audience completely well. For example, if there is an expert sitting in your class, and if you are starting talking about something elementary, then the entire discourse will go haywire. It gets disturbed. And therefore, considering the entry behavior is very, very important. You need to bring your class before your eyes while preparing your lecture. You know your students better, and therefore you will know which kind of question will come from which corner, and therefore you need to be prepared to answer these questions. You need to anticipate questions, and you need to go to the classroom only when you have answers for all the questions which you think your students will have. Then you become a successful teacher, and then students will start respecting you, and then students will start automatically attending your classes, whether you're giving attendance, not giving attendance. So you don't need to keep them as captive audience inside the classroom under the threat of attendance. If the students know that this is one class where I will certainly have some outcome of attending this lecture, and this is a teacher who is going to answer me all my queries, and you see the change. The classroom is going to work out magic. So it's going to be completely different, and therefore it's very important. And the third important step while preparing a lecture is, you need to prioritize the contents. So you need to note down in while preparing a lecture that I'm going to talk about this. This is, nowadays people call it as, keywords. That there are certain essential words that you need to make your students familiar as far as a particular subject. See, I just Googled for an image and then put this image, but it's not relevant for law. It's just, I think, something related to computer science, which talks about word processing. But then if we need to prepare a spray diagram like this, for example, if I am going to talk about the basic structure doctrine, right? So I need to talk about the evolution of basic structure doctrine. I need to talk about Keshavananda Bharati's case. I need to talk about A.K. Gopalan's case. I need to talk about certain other cases. So you just note down that which are the important cases. I need to note down few names of judges who were involved in coming out with this doctrine. You also, if you trace the evolution, you also can find out who was the lawyer who was arguing and who made this line of argument that this constitution has a basic structure which should not be amended. And where did this idea come from? Who was that lawyer who told the court that there is a basic structure which should not be amended? And what was he relying upon? Where did he get this idea from? Interestingly, I do not know how many of you know this. You know, Mr. Nambiar, when he first argued about Keshe, M.K. Nambiar, when he argued about this basic structure doctrine, it was his line of argument for the first time. And you see that Mr. M.K. Nambiar got this idea of basic structure doctrine and argued before the Supreme Court by relying upon a judgment which was delivered by the Pakistan court in the year 1963. So this is something important. So you need to know what are very, very important thing, you know, which you should not miss talking about it in a classroom. So you arrange it, you know, these are the keywords which you should not miss in the class. And within that 40 minutes, 50 minutes, if you are planning that you need to talk about all these things. So put those keywords so that you don't miss out on anything. So that is the idea of prioritizing contents. And then once you have all the contents prioritized, you have identified contents, now you will have to prioritize it. So this is a kind of an inverse triangle, like, so you can see this. The bottom is very important, what you must tell them in the class. So that should go at the bottom of your lecture. So that should be the core of your lecture, what you must tell them. Your student must know about basic structure doctrine. These are the things which a student must know about basic structure. And then, you know, what should they know apart from this? So what is the must? And then you can see what should be taught to them. And then, you know, if time permits, you have another opportunity to teach, or if you have one more class where you can further elaborate on this, then you can identify these things on code. So if you just look at it, first is you need to identify the keywords and put all the points that whatever you have found out while reading and while preparing for a lecture on basic structure. And after that, then you arrange all these things under these three headings. What I must teach them, which is very, very essential for completing a lecture on this topic, and what I should tell them, and maybe if time permits and if I have more times and if I do not have questions, then I could cover certain other things. Maybe then you can get into the judgment of the Pakistan court and then tell them, you know, how Pakistan court had come out with this basic structure doctrine, right? So that is how you need to prioritize content. This is something which you will have to do it while preparing a lecture. This happens one day before, not on the day of the lecture. You should always keep it, you know, ready in hand. And then once you prepare a lecture scientifically by following these methods, then it becomes very important. Now, how will you know that what is must and what is should and what is could? That is based on the previous one. You know, how do you prioritize the content? But when will you use the must, when you should use the should, and when you should use the could? All these things, you know, it is again based on certain science. See, every human being has a little of the concentration level of each student varies. But generally, if you generalize the class, if the period of maximum effectiveness is just 20 or 30 minutes. So you have a period of, say, you have a period of 40 minutes or 50 minutes class.
So how do you structure that class? You know, what you, so first is when you enter a class, when students are coming and settling down, you can't directly talk to them about the importance of, you can't directly talk to them about Keshavananda Bharati, a judgment, and from there you can't talk about basic structure. So you need to slowly raise their attention, you know. So it's a gradual process. When you start talking for the first 10 minutes, you need to create an interest in the subject. In fact, I'm going to talk about it when I'll be dealing with the delivery. How are you going to deliver a lecture? There I'm going to tell you what you should do to raise the attention span and take the students from 0 to 100. And how do we sustain that interest at 100 level for a maximum of 30 minutes? And after 30 minutes, you can't do much. Automatically, the attention of your student will fall down, which will be very, very visible if you are maintaining a very proper eye contact with your student. If you can understand the body language of your students, now you should know that it's time for you to wind up your presentation and now get out of the class. So that, and how do you now wind it up? How do you gradually allow them, you know, to drop their attention level? And during that next 10 minutes, what you will do? So this is something which this diagram talks about. When we talk about attention span, this is something which all teachers need to know, that the attention, the moment you start lecturing, it's not 100%. So the student will not have an 100% attention level the moment you start delivering a lecture. He will gradually will rise up to that level. And therefore, you need to know what you will do till the time he reaches that 100% level. And then, you know, you need to start teaching very effectively to ensure that the attention level is maintained. And at a particular stage, once you start looking into the body language of the students, you know, which you will be able to know as an experienced teacher, if you look into the eyes of your students, you will realize that the attention is already started coming down, and therefore now you should start winding up your lecture in a way, and therefore, you know, there is a maximum use of the time, entire 50 minutes. So it will not go waste. Nothing will go waste. Even if their attention span is less, you need to know what you should talk when the attention span is less. You need to know what you need to talk when the attention span is at its peak, and you need to know what to do, what to talk to your students when the student is losing his attention. So this is something, this is science. And this is what I told in the previous episode also, that unfortunately we were not told about the science about it, and we do not know the how to read the body language of another person. And you know, how do you actually look into the eyes of a student, and what can you learn from the eyes of that student? These are, in fact, you know, very, very important skill sets which teachers need to have. Then, as I told you, the generation is changing. The olden day law schools had a lot of very senior people. Many of them joined a law school after their bachelor's degree and master's degree, when India had only 3-year law degree program. But since now we have a 5-year law degree program where we get students directly from the schools. So now there is a need for a change in the teaching aids that we need to use. So they, in the schools, they are used to their teacher using a lot of teaching aids inside the classroom. But in a university, generally, we don't see teachers carrying any teaching aids into the classroom, except that you carry a chalk piece or a marker, or you either carry a pointer where the classrooms have projectors. So you just point with your laser points and then you start talking. So therefore, we at law schools do not use visual aids that much in conveying the ideas, the legal ideas that whatever we are talking. But it is possible if you start preparing for a lecture scientifically, you can actually learn how to make visual aids. Because if you see this diagram, the power of the senses, you know, when I say power of the senses, it's the power of recall. When students will be able to remember and they will be able to take it inside, and when they can recall, the effectiveness of recalling the knowledge which has gone into their memory is by sight. You can see sight, 75% they will be able to recall. So therefore, and it's not something impossible. I have tried always in my classes with a lot of visuals, whatever subjects I taught. Even in international law classes, when I was teaching public international, I used to carry a lot of international visual aids. And I'll be very surprised when the end semester paper comes for evaluation, I see students elaborating principles with diagrams. So that had an impact, and that is easy for them also recollect, remember, put it, reproduce it in the paper. So that's I have personally experienced. I have a great, very good experience as far as using visual aids, and therefore, this is something. So this is again emphasizing the same point. So this is what, you know. For example, you keep talking, you know, the way I am now talking to all of you. If you keep talking, you know, you just listen to it, and maybe after 15 minutes, you will be able to remember 50% of it. Maybe tomorrow, you will be able to remember 30% of it. After 15 days, maybe you will say that he spoke about the lecture. That's all. You will not be able to remember all these things. Therefore, just by hearing, you know, whatever you hear, number one, the facts gets distorted. If you go and tell somebody that today I heard a lecture by Shantakumar and he was talking about this, and if somebody asks, okay, you will tell me what did he speak, then you will tell something, you know, completely different than what I say. That this is how, you know, people get quoted out of context, because when just by hearing, you will not be able to recollect, and the facts always gets distorted. This is a proven scientific fact, that the facts gets distorted just by hearing, and you pass it on to another person. By the time it reaches the 10th person, I think you will be getting a lot of WhatsApp memes on this particular thing, how facts gets distorted when the same set of facts is told to one person, he tells to another person, he tells to the other person, and finally when it reaches the 10th person, he tells something completely different. It's different from what person number one told. So therefore, it's very, very important to have more visuals. For example, see this beautiful building. Now you show this building to your students in the class, and then, you know, tell them that this beautiful monument is called Taj Mahal. I think your work is done. And then you can talk much about Taj Mahal. Why was it built? How was it built? And when was it built? All these things, you can keep talking about it. If you, for example, if this picture is not there with you, how will you describe this beautiful monument in a class? What will you do for 60 minutes talking about this? And how? And what will happen is, at the end of 60th minute, after your class, if you ask your students to draw based upon your lecture, you will see 60 different types of buildings. So this is one point which I hope all of you will agree with me, that if you show the picture, it has tremendous impact, and people will never forget it. Even after 10 years, they will remember your class. I know that, you know, I'm meeting students after 25 years, and still they say that, sir, I remember. I say that, do you remember me? He says, sir, how can I forget you? This lecture, you know, this thing you said, this thing you drew. Oh, so that's how people remember you, and therefore it will create a lasting impact if you can do this. Yeah, the next important equipment before, I've seen many people getting inside the class and then they keep looking around. Where is the cable for the projector? Where is this marker? Where is the duster? And then, you know. So what happens, you know, you waste 5-10 minutes in looking at all these teaching aids. And then what happens, the audience, the participants, the students get disturbed.
then they will keep starting talking with them something new, and then you will not be able to control the cat. You will have to raise your voice, hey, keep quiet, shut down, no, listen to me, look at me, and all these things, which is not required if your class is ready with all teaching aids. When you enter the class, you should go completely prepared. So preparation is not only about, you know, creating content for your lecture, but it is also about checking your equipment, teaching aids, and other things. So this is something very important. For example, you know, today during this presentation, I was not able to put this presentation before you on the screen. Just because, you know, we were not, because I presumed that I should have told the host that I am using a PPT and therefore you give me the access. I did not do that. I did not test it. So therefore what happened, we had to, during the process of the lecture, I had to wait for 3-4 minutes, 5 minutes, trying to do upload, and then I called the host and then he immediately gave access. These things we could have easily avoided if we would have prepared for it. And you know, 10 minutes before the lecture, if we could have checked, okay, I'm going to share this PPT, see whether it is working, then the host would have immediately given access, and therefore during the lecture. So in spite of all these experiences, because that I was not prepared, I took for granted that, okay, Zoom has shared the option, so I press the share button, I will be able to share it. But I did not check it. So I knew that this facility is there. Same thing, you know that your class has a projector, but you might not know that whether that cable is working, whether the projector is working, there is a power backup, whether you have the relevant, the right cable, because nowadays I find that most of the laptops do not come with this kind of a printer cable. So you will have to now carry a HDMI cable wherever it is goes, because your projector was purchased some 10 years back and it is already fixed on the ceiling. So now you'll have to go with the relevant cable. So all these things are very, very important. You need to check your equipment, check your teaching aid so that it goes undisturbed. So I think this is going to into the second part of my lecture, structuring the lecture, which I already told you that how, when you structure a lecture, put the must in the core, and then if time permits, then you should talk about certain things. And if still you have time, then, you know, and all these things should be pointed towards the objective for which you are delivering this lecture. What is the most important thing which will help me to attain the object of this lecture? I should tell that first. Then I should tell, you know, the remaining things. So this is what you need to do. As I, this we have already discussed, so I'm not going to deal much with it. So this is again, when you structure the content, as I told you, keeping the attention span in mind, you should you know how you will introduce this class, how will you introduce your topic to the class in the first 10 minutes till you take the students' attention from 0 to 100. So that is that portion is called the beginning. So you can see on the right side, it said, you know, that is the time when you prepare the student to actually listen to your instructions. And when you know that the class has reached the attention span at 100, then that is the actual time when you need to carry out the instruction. The actual learning happens during that time, what is known as the middle part of your lecture. Then the moment if you feel that the attention is falling down, then you should start winding up your lecture, you should end. And that's where, and you need to know what you should do at the end, how you will have to consolidate. And you can't abruptly say that, okay, today it's over, tomorrow I'll continue. No, that's not the way you should end this session. You should, you know, briefly summarize what you discussed in the 40-50 minutes, because even someone who was not attentive during that period, you will have a final opportunity chance to know that what you spoke about in the last 40-50 minutes. And then you need to also test, ask them, you know, you have understood, whether you will be able to tell this, whether you'll be able to remember this case law. So you just ask random few questions to test their knowledge and understanding, and that's how it works. So this is what, you know, the from 0 to A is that, you know, beginning part. A to B is the middle part, and B to end is the end part, which you need to do, which we have already spoken. So therefore, we are not going to discuss about it.
This is a small, you know, for example, this is again an image which I picked up from the Google, importance of structuring. For example, if you put all these objects and then say that, you know, can you remember all these things? So there are different things, you know, there is an ink bottle, there is a hammer, there is a watch, there is a pencil, there is a saw, there is a tie, there is a diary. So you find a lot of things in this image. Say, assume that, you know, after you talk about all these things and then after 10 minutes, okay, you ask your students, you know, can you just write down what all things that you saw, and they will not be able to do it. In fact, in a physical form, I use this drawing as an exercise for the participants. So I ask, you know, some of them to go out, and for some of them, I show this picture and I ask them to, then I close the screen and I ask them to write down how many objects they remember. Rarely they will be able to remember, hardly they will be able to remember some 5, 6, 7 items, not more than that. But if I show them this picture, now these are the same thing, now we have structured it. These are, you know, stationary items. You have the ink, the pencil, the pin, there is a stapler. And these are smoking items. There is a cigar, there is a cigarette, there is a matchstick, there is an ashtray. Similarly, these are, you know, wearable items. There is a watch, tie pin, a goggle, and a tie. And these are the tools. Now, students will be able to recollect. Okay, sir told about 4 things. Stationery, smoking, wear, hand tools. And each had 5 items, so 4 × 5, 20 items. So people will be able to remember this. And whenever we do a practical training session, you show this diagram to another group of people, and that group of people to whom we show this structured diagram, they will be able to recollect at least 14, 15 out of this 20. Whereas the same picture, the previous one, if we show it to them, people will hardly remember 5 and 6. The same thing, the moment it is structured, you will be able to recollect it very well. People will be able to understand it very well. So you will have to logically teach something. You know? If you are teaching basic structure, you will have to proceed in a logical manner. Not, you know, first you will not start with Keshavananda, then you don't go back to A.K. Gopal, and then you don't go to Sajjan Singh. You know, then it becomes a big mess of, people will not be able to trace the evolution. So arrange things chronologically and tell them the stages of development, and then it will be easy. So that is the importance of structure. Now, I have a very few more minutes. I don't know whether I'll be able to complete it by 5. Because while delivering lecture, as I told you, delivering a lecture, how do you do that? Again, keeping, you know, going back to the attention span diagram from 0 to 100, that time at the beginning of a lecture, what you need to do. That's what I have put an acronym there. Intro. I stands for creating interest. You need to start talking to the students about the importance of the subject, why this subject is important, you know. So you should explain the need for the lecture. Tell them that what is the title of the lecture, you emphasize, re-emphasize. And you also tell them that what you intend to cover during the next 40, 45 minutes. And also tell them the object of this lecture and the outcome, that how they will be benefited by this lecture. So this will actually, you know, this is the time when you do all these things, the attention span would have gradually gone from 0 to 100. So that is why you can't directly get into the subject, rather you should import it. That's why for the first 5-10 minutes of this presentation, in my session also, I was talking more about lecture method and why lecture method is important, why we will have to learn about it in spite of so many other methods of teaching, why we should spend more time on lecture and all these things. So I tried to create interest in all of you, that lecture is not something you can ignore. It's a very important teaching method in law schools, and therefore we need to learn it scientifically and then start practicing it. So that was the real thing that you need to do for the first 10 minutes. Then, you know, then in the middle is actually the content. You should go to the content once you reach the 100 level, 100 points on an attention span.
you then cover the content of your lecture. Then you order it, structure it. Then, you know, you try and use maximum visuals, use eye contacts, reinforce certain very important words. So there are certain keywords which you will have to keep repeating if you want your students to know that this is something very, very important which they should not miss as far as this topic is concerned. Therefore, you will have to reinforce this. So this is something which you need to know. And And the, as I told you, when you have completed the lecture, you can understand from your body language of the students that they have started losing the attention, and therefore now you will have to end up by summarizing. Now I'll summarize today that in the initial stage, in the initial part of my presentation, I spoke about the importance of lecture, how lecture is an indispensable method of law teaching. And therefore, in this entire program, we discussed about how we need to prepare for a lecture, how we need to structure the lecture, right? And how to use more visuals in the lecture. And then we are trying to now wind up by telling how do you deliver a lecture. So this is something, you know, you need to summarize your entire 30 minutes of talk on the topic. You will have to summarize in the next 3 minutes and say that this is what we did. So it's easy. In the intro part, you will have to tell them that what you are going to do. And in the middle part, you will have to actually do that, what you intend to do in that class. And then at the end, when you end, you will have to tell them what you did during the last 30 minutes. That's all. It's very simple. Only thing is you'll have to systematically prepare for it and plan for it. And then it's easy. So you will have to link it with certain other topics. You know, maybe you can ask them like, so today I discussed about lecture. Now try and find out what are the other methods available maybe for the next class, which we can talk about. Why don't you look at the writings of Langdell, you know, Christopher Columbus Langdell on the case method. So why don't we discuss, we will, you know, maybe after this, finishing this lecture, we will be discussing about the case method, which is again a very, very well-practiced method in most of the law schools. Therefore, next method that we will do is, so you link this topic with the next topic so that the students know that, okay, next class is going to be something. So they will start doing some homework. And then to test their understanding, you should ask questions to see whether they have actually understood another thing. And then you can also now refer to certain materials. Like, you know, there is a book on law lecturing. It's a small book, some 100, 110 pages book published by Cardiff University, Wales, UK. So you can just Google for a book on law lecturing. So you will get that book. So please read that book, and then you will get more tips that you need to know about lecturing. So that's how you extend the learning of your class. So this is not the only thing that you need to know. There are certain other things about this topic. So you please go and read these things, so that the students also will have the feeling that, okay, I have a basic idea. If I want to advance my knowledge on this particular topic, let me go and search for this material as suggested by my teacher. So that's what is called as the extended language. So this, you know, we have created an acronym called SLATE. What you need to do, summarize, link with the next topic, how this topic is going to be important for you to understand. Otherwise, you will not be able to understand the next topic. So therefore, you again emphasize the importance of this topic, linking it, asking questions, testing the understanding, and extending the learning. So this is, again, you know, there are certain other tips. As I told, I will end this session with a few tips, delivery tips. So this is one thing what Einstein says, if you can't explain it simply, which means you don't understand it well enough. So if you want to be a great teacher, you need to explain everything in a very simple way, so that even, because your focus is not on the front benches, you have every classroom as a back bench. And you need to ensure that those guys are also taken along. So a teacher always has to be inclusive. He has no option. So he can't selectively teach students, you know, who are very fast learners. there are average learners, there are weak learners, slow learners, so you will have to concentrate on them as well. So that's why you will have to use the most. So these are the certain very small tips that which I will use to end this lecture. So while we are talking, because we need to follow this, first tip is use very slow measured terms. Use pauses and intonations. Allow the listener to take it to his heart, because students also make value judgment. They can't, when they are listening to you, they are making notes, they also need to, to digest this information, and they will make their own value judgment whether whatever my teacher is telling, this is important, whether I should write it or not. So they, you should allow them at least that time to decide whether the student needs to note it down or not, right? So you need to maintain your lecture in a very slow, measured terms, so that the student gets time, a few seconds in between to make such value judgments. Then the second important tip is keep language very simple and clear, because already the language of law is so complex, and if law teachers also make it, quite very complex because of a very difficult language that you use in the class. As I told, you will have to cater to everyone in the classroom. Therefore, try and keep your language as simple and clear as much as possible, without distorting the meaning of the law, without distorting the language of the law. Then the third important tip is signposting. Use the language of moment. You should tell them that before I told this, yesterday I told this, tomorrow I'll be telling this, just before this I mentioned it. Can you just go back to the one slide where I showed you a picture of Taj Mahal? So you will also have to give them the direction of movement so that the student will travel along with you. So that is very, very important. Signposting is something very, very important. And break the lecture into small recognizable part. Don't, start at the beginning and end with one continuous topic. So in between, make it into smaller topics. So let me talk about Keshavananda Bharati now. Yes, that's all. So in this part, first you talk about, now you say, let me talk about the doctrine of basic structure now. Let me talk about Article 368 now. I'm now talking about A.K. Gopal. So make it into smaller parts. You don't need to actually draw a line to distinguish, but then, you will have to very frequently remind the students that I am now, for the next few minutes, I am going to discuss about this. So when the lecture is divided into smaller parts, then it's easy for the students to follow it up. Then these are other housekeeping tips that please do not use different color markers, because it's now currently available. People start using it in green and red and other thing, especially people who are color blind. They will find it very difficult to read it. Similarly, for example, if you are preparing a slide, one small tip. This is only one example. There are multiple things that you need to learn as a teacher. For example, if you justify the right margin. So it's studies say that people with dyslexia, they really get irritated. So the students get irritated, annoyed. They find it difficult to sit in your class if you justify your margin. But we feel that, just for the sake of good look, we justify the margin, both left margin and right margin, and then we take the slide to our classroom. Then the most important thing is body language. So you can't stand straight and keep talking, looking at one particular portion of your class. So you should be very flexible. You should walk around, move around, use your hands freely, use your face, your facial expression matters. You can, feel free to use body language, appropriate body language. Again, if you make some funny body language, then you'll be mocked by the entire class. Definitely in their farewell, they are going to talk about your body language, your movement and other things. So that should not be the kind of body language. You should use appropriate, acceptable, a scholarly body language to just convey your ideas, to convey your meaning. And therefore, in fact, there are a lot of literature available on body language. Please go through it, and then you will understand what is appropriate, what is inappropriate in a class. when boys are there, girls are there, and 60 people are there. So what is an appropriate body language? Am I supposed to use my hands like this? Am I not supposed to use like this? So all these things you need to know. And most important delivery tip is the way you dress. It's very, very important. So it's not necessary that you should always, you know, go with a formal suit and all this thing. Dress appropriately. If you do not dress appropriately, then, you know, students might not take you seriously. And therefore, you will have to be a bit cautious when you are dressing up for teaching. So therefore, these are some of the important tips that I thought I wanted to teach. And therefore, this is the last slide. And in fact, this slide talks about using example as a tool to teach, because use plenty of examples. Einstein says example is not another way to teach. It is the only way to teach. You know, whatever you teach, teach with an example. Today, I took basic structure and Article 368 in Keshavananda Bharati as an example. So wherever it is possible, I was using that example to convey my ideas. And therefore, for every lecture, go to the class with an example, and which an example which is very familiar to your class, so that they will be able to relate whatever you are speaking to that through that example. So this is one last tip. And I know these are, you know, when you start doing it systematically, it will definitely hurt you. It will take time. It will require dedication. It will require willpower. You'll need to make a lot of healthy decisions. It requires sacrifice. You'll need to push your body to its maximum, because you're doing a lot of things, you know, to prepare a lecture. There will be temptation, but I promise you, when you reach your goal, it's worth it. In fact, I'm a big beneficiary of all these things, and therefore, I think the same thing can work to you as well. So this is all. Thank you so much. I have exceeded by 10 minutes. Sorry for that, but thank you so much for this opportunity.